the Weekly Feed. I'm Kyle Meredith, and Taylor and Matt here from Local Natives. And welcome back, because second album, Hummingbird, this beautiful record that I don't think any of us knew what to expect from Local Natives. Because when a band comes out swinging, kind of like you guys do, when you have something like Gorilla Manor that, I'm not going to say it changed the world, but it probably changed a few people's lives in one way or the other. You know, it was something that was different and didn't sound like each other, and it was just monstrous. I couldn't stop listening to it. And then when you become a fan of a band like that, and I don't know if you guys have ever had that experience, but it suddenly becomes like, oh God, they're going to make a new record. What if it's not as good? What if I don't like it, you know? So luckily, Hummingbird is this beautiful record. So
thank you.
Yeah, cool. Congratulations on that one.
Thank you so much.
In fact, I wrote something here, and I'm not a writer, but I wanted to read this just how I wrote it, leading into some of these questions here, because I said, there's really something about your music that screams summer. Like the hazier days when everything seems just a little bit lost and out of control. And I guess that's how I see it. It's this vibrant music, but it almost seems like there's something always searching inside. Do you guys feel that? Is there any truth to that, you know, from the artist's point of view? Because I think there's always a thing about fans hear the music sometimes differently than the artist probably intended.
Yeah. Yeah, man, I think that that definitely has a ring to it, because, well, the two albums are very different.
Yeah.
And we were in a similar situation as you were, you know, going into our second album. What's it gonna be? And we didn't know.
Right.
We kind of didn't have a grand architecture for it. It just came out how it did, and I think really expressed where we were in our lives. But I would say both albums do kind of have that feel. I mean, we're an LA band, and we love being in LA, and we kind of like rep that. But I think that probably has that feel to it or something. But the haziness, especially with Hummingbird, that was just time where we were really going through a lot, kind of as a band, emotionally and as a family and everything, and it was a very cathartic record for us. So I would say that searching was, yeah, definitely kind of a theme of it.
Yeah. Would you call this a transition record?
I mean, it's our second album, so
and maybe that's a question to ask you two albums from now.
Yeah, like, exactly.
Was Hummingbird the transition record? Because again, it is quite different in a lot of ways from the first record.
And I feel like we're in a very different place today. You know, I think Hummingbird and everything that kind of symbolized for us, and just dealing with like death in the family and just these really heavy topics, that's kind of like through us now, and we're just in this very different place, and everybody's really pumped and excited, and you know what I mean? So I think it is definitely going to pivot off again and be another thing where it's not really like the last record.
Right. I think most bands, having to deal with what you've done and putting it into a record, you get that on your first record or you get that on your fifth record. To have to do it on the sophomore record when there's really a lot of attention, like, oh, can they do it again? You know, that's rough.
Yeah.
I mean, it's personally, I'm not, you know, talking about your personal lives. That's obviously rough. But to have to inject that exactly at that time in a career.
Right, yeah. You know, you always think, oh, it's fine, that's no problem. But that pressure is kind of crazy to go through. And I think for us, we have each other. It's such a collaborative band and writing experience. We have each other to really, really lean on.
Right.
It's not just on the shoulders of one person.
Yeah.
So I think that was really helpful for us just to focus on making music together.
I mean, relationships they're hard to keep together when you're not in a band. Have you guys learned actually how to control your personal lives now? You know, how many years is this? I mean, we're 5, 6 years?
Eight years, I think.
Something
now.
Like that.
Yeah.
For most of us. Yeah, I mean, we lived together for a while at a certain point, and
yeah.
We've been touring for 5, 6 years pretty heavily now. And
you think you've got it down? Because, you know, most people on the outside, they don't know the lives. It's still a romantic image, and we all know about all the sitting around and everything, you know, between us
and
what it really, really is. But
but
there is that whole thing about how do you take hold of that? There are some people that, you know, once they get older, they never leave the road. When you look at Dylan or Neil Young or something like that, they never.
Willie Nelson.
Yeah, like they can't. It's like the guy who was in jail the whole time, and he gets out, he's like, no.
Yeah,
you know?
He wants to go back immediately.
when you get off of tour, there's a very real come down.
Yeah.
It really is a drug to be performing for thousands of people. Is this really awesome experience that you get to have be your job is just super insane and kind of surreal, but you get used to it so fast.
Yeah.
And you just get used to kind of that lifestyle of being on the road. And I think there's always this pretty intense crash when you come home.
I think I read a Bono quote once. He has a deal with his wife that she won't talk to him for like 3 days after he gets back.
Really?
It's that whole idea about walking into the supermarket, like something, the most mundane thing that just seems so alien.
Yeah.
Once you're off, you've done 5 months on the road, and suddenly you're pushing the cart down the aisle looking for the milk and bread.
Yeah. Well, I don't know that we're at the Bono level.
Yeah.
He has a harder time in the supermarket getting his vegetables.
I cannot picture Bono picking out like 2%.
Yeah, he's like, honey.
2%, 1%.
Honey, don't talk to me.
Soy milk.
I'm just gonna
there's only like, 2,000 people in Ireland. They all know him.
They're all buddies.
For Hummingbird, I'm sure it's different on an indie label, French Kiss, versus a major label would be, but how did they take it when you gave them Hummingbird? I mean, was it a thing where they're like, wow, this is different? You know, did you guys ever have to suffer any of that?
Like, where are the singles?
Where are the singles?
What's with this shit?
I mean, Heavy Feet's a great single. I mean, you know, nothing against
for sure. Yeah. You know what, our label, that one and then the one abroad, the UK is called Infectious, and
yeah.
I have to speak for both labels because they were super amazing and supportive throughout it. We did Gorilla Manor on our own and came to the labels with the album done.
Yeah.
And then for Hummingbird, they just said, do what you want. We'll see you when it's done. And of course, it took us a long time because we toured for so long and because some of the things that happened right as we were starting to record. And they were just super supportive. Then we turned it in. They said, oh, it's awesome. We love it. And
that's nice to have.
Can't wait to work with it. Yeah, it was like the whole horror story. You know, we've been in a band since we were kids. Yeah. And we made some stupid deals working with some shady
really?
People.
So you've had those moments.
Oh, yeah. When we were like in high school and everything, you know. So once we kind of figured it out, I think working with these labels has been such a great experience, and they were just nothing but supportive for us.
From some of these tracks, you guys co-wrote. Is that the first time you've ever done that? And that was with Desner,
right?
Who produced it. Was that the first time you've done that? Because that seems like a different world, co-writing.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, it was... when we met up with Aaron, we were just on tour with the National. They brought us out for a couple dates, and...
Yeah.
We were talking to him about the record, just kind of backstage after the shows or whatever, and struck up a friendship, and he was a fan of the band, and that was cool, and it was really not in our heads at all to work with him.
Yeah.
That wasn't a thing we had kind of, you know, pre-worked out, but we thought of that idea, sent him off an email, and he was super psyched, and ended up dedicating kind of like months of his life to produce the record with us. And
I've heard you guys talking about the studio and his house and everything.
Yeah,
and
we were living in his house with
like
him and his new baby and his
right.
wife, you know. It was really, really awesome, intimate experience for us. And yeah, we hadn't worked with somebody that intensely with kind of co-producing the album. But what I think worked with Aaron is that he's in a band, he has his own thing going on. And so he really let us just be like, hey, this is your...
Yeah.
This is your guys' band. This is your, you know, thing. And so that was cool to have somebody, like a producer who also understood the band ego, insane dynamic.
I guess that's where my question comes in, because, you know, he gets writing credit. It's one thing to have a producer, and most producers just, you know, they get the producer, but rarely do they get some of the writing credit.
Right.
Well, we
basically invite him to be like a fifth band member during the process. And we had spent 9 months on these songs before he came in, and you know, there were a couple songs that we reworked with him in the room, so it just made sense to be like, yeah man, like that.
It's the Nashville machine way of saying a word for a third.
A word for a third.
That's how they get paid down there.
Dang.
You need to change those two words there and go ahead and pay up.
They send in the big guns. Send in the big guns. They'll change the like the tense right. of the song.
Yeah.
Speaking of Nashville, though, you guys covered Johnny Cash, which is super cool. That, I mean, it seems like that's nothing these days. Everybody covers everybody. But it got me thinking about, even just a couple decades ago, how bands were very much in a box. It was before rock. They didn't mix with country, you know, rarely or something. You'd get kind of one of those rogue artists. But, you know, these days it almost seems like, I don't know if it's a generational thing or whatever, but completely washed away. You know, no band has to be defined by a single sound anymore. You know, you guys can cover Johnny Cash. You know, Phoenix can do an acoustic Bob Dylan song.
Yeah.
I mean, do you ever see that? You ever look at it and it's like, oh, yeah. It's like Aladdin. It's a whole new world.
It's like Aladdin. Every day.
Exactly what I think.
Every day we sing that song.
Then you ride off on a magic carpet.
Yeah. Exactly, man. Yeah, I think that kind of being open and collaborative and this whole process that's begun to happen with bands covering each other and working together all the time, that's something that we were kind of insulated from just starting out. And actually, I have to say, working with Aaron was a huge way that opened up for us. You know, he...
To be able to do that type of stuff.
Well, with his brother, he produced that... what is it?
Dark Was the Night, right?
Yeah. You remember that. Mm-hmm. And it just had all these artists on it doing all these amazing songs. And
Danger Man, that was it.
He's just kind of plugged into this community of all these musicians playing together on each other's stuff all the time.
Yeah.
And so experiencing that was really cool, and I think actually opened us up a little bit to...
Was there a time when you would have been more reluctant to do something like that? Like, nah, that's not really us.
I don't know, not cover Johnny Cash. I mean,
I guess Johnny Cash transcends. He does.
Johnny Cash is cool no matter what, you know? But I think, I think maybe it would have been a little bit more precious with, are we going to, you know, lend ourselves to, like, jam on this Friends thing, or would we be as open to jumping on this compilation or just covering... You know, whatever. So, I think we are more open to it now.
Are you thinking ahead? Or are you guys already thinking about what comes next?
Yeah.
As far as the music and everything, is that already kind of in the plans?
Yeah, we've been kind of off tour. This is kind of like a one-off for us, and been back at home in our studio and just trying to write as much as possible, and starting to work on pieces of record 3. So.
Never stops.
Never ends. Yeah. But it's good.
It's really exciting. We really are in an awesome place with writing right now, and it's feeling really good, and these festivals are super fun to do, but it has turned into this thing where, like, I want to be in the studio, you know, because of travel day. So our flight was canceled yesterday. Oh, you heard this? Yeah.
And then, oh no, are the instruments going to show up?
No, this is a separate issue. Our flight was canceled yesterday. We were supposed to get in last night at a reasonable time, but that was canceled, so we flew at midnight, and we've been flying all night. And we landed here at noon. And so none of us have slept. And it's just like the weekend fly-in, fly-out thing being so easy. Yeah. You know, it's not as easy as it pretends that it's going to be.
Local natives as weekend warriors.
Exactly, right? Yeah.
Yep.
No, but it's awesome. We're actually expanding into a bigger studio right now. Yeah. The one that we made Hummingbird in. We just feel like we've outgrown it a little bit. We've got way too much gear now, so we got.
Is it premature to ask about the direction? I mean, are you guys seeing that at this point?
I would say it's premature.
Yeah,
just because our process, songs morph so many times by the end, but there are definitely already kind of themes that we were all agreed upon. Actually, in a way that's different from Hummingbird. Everybody was just kind of like you had started the interview with. I have no idea what this album's going to be. That's where we started. But this, we actually have. More of a coalesced idea. Though talking about it right now would probably be
I understand. Yeah. We'll do that interview next time.
Yeah.
All right. It's so great to see you guys. Thank you for stopping by.
Thanks for having us.
Have a great forecastle.